This is Speaking of Pets Podcast, where we give you up-to-date, accurate, science-based information when making decisions about your pet's health.
From experts in dermatology like my sister, surgery, internal medicine, CBD use in pets, the pet food industry, you name it. If it affects pets, we'll talk about it.
Today's Speaking of Pets Podcast is sponsored by Blue Buffalo, the maker of natural pet foods. Love them like family, feed them like family.
Blue Buffalo offers wholesome, meat-first recipes with high-quality natural ingredients in flavors dogs and cats love. Discover formulas for all breed sizes, life stages, and lifestyles. And with Blue Buffalo's True Blue Promise, that assures that real meat is the first ingredient, with no poultry byproducts, no corn, wheat, or soy, and no artificial flavors or preservatives.
Hi, I'm Dr. Alice Novotny-Jeroman, a board-certified veterinary allergist and dermatologist, and...
I'm her sister, and I am not. I'm Janet Novotny-King, and I am not a board-certified allergist and dermatologist. I'm a pet rescuer and pet lover, and we're here to get some really good science-based information out to you so you can be a better pet owner.
Hey, Janet. The other day, I was talking to two of my former clients that adopt beagles, and... they live kind of in southern Ohio, around Columbus, and they each own three beagles each. And sadly, one has bladder cancer and, you know, things like that. But did you know that beagles are the most found breed? These two owners of six beagles total didn't go to a shelter or adopt. They just found these dogs. These dogs came walking out of the woods. And I think, especially in southern Ohio, it's kind of that dog won't hunt type thing, and they just let him go. Let me tell you, these six beagles with these two owners are living the high life now. Thank God for that.
Aww.
But
well, who doesn't love a beagle? Shout out to Snoopy.
I always say, gotta love a beagle. You know, every time I think of beagle, it's when the dishwasher's open and they're in there doing the pre-wash. You know what I'm saying? Anyway.
That's an important job.
It is.
That's better than Cascade.
Today, we are so... I have such a fan crush. The founder of the Beagle Freedom Project, Shannon Keith, is here. She's an attorney. She's an award-winning filmmaker. She's an advocate for all animals. But she established the Beagle Freedom Project in 2010. Since then, they've rescued over 3,500 animals from these labs that do all these horrible, they test floor cleaners on them, I mean, cosmetics, pharmaceuticals. And these animals usually get put to sleep, they usually get killed, okay? But thanks to Shannon's group, they get adopted out into wonderful homes like all of us would give them. And even more important than that is getting legislation in the states across this country to prevent this from happening, to A, stop this testing, and B, to get these dogs out of these places and cats as well and get them into good homes. And they have their signature legislation, the Beagle Freedom Bill, is now in 13 states. So it's a start. We've got a long way to go, but I'm so proud of her. I think it just goes to show you that one person can make a difference, and the power of the love for animals and the human-animal bond is just really something. So Shannon, thank you so much for spending time with us today.
Welcome, Shannon.
Oh, thank you. I'm honored to be here. Thank you so much for having me. What a great introduction.
Well, I hate to gush too much, but you're doing something I've always dreamed of doing, getting these dogs and cats out of there and trying to give them a normal life. And explain how that's going. I mean, do most of the dogs adjust after a while once they get into loving homes?
Yes, they do. They definitely adjust. And that's something that the opposition absolutely hates, because they love to say that, oh, they won't adjust. They were bred to be test subjects, and that's why we can't release them. We must kill them. Well, that's, of course, absolutely not true, because we have thousands of reasons to show you how they have adjusted. They eventually adjust. Obviously, the younger ones adjust much better. Sometimes they adjust immediately, especially the puppies. sometimes it takes a little bit longer, and you will see the PTSD last, but all they want is love. And I always say, we have so much to learn from them, because as much as human beings have hurt them and done horrible things to them, they still just simply want love.
Yeah.
That is all they want. In fact, on our very first rescue, which is what started me on, which was started Beagle Freedom Project, the person who worked at the lab said to me, look at them. They're so forgiving. That's why they use them. And I, my heart melted. I said, whoa, wow. I have got to spread that message of they use them because they're forgiving. Mm. How sad.
But why so do they use? Why are beagles the breed? Like, why are they in all these labs?
And that's exactly why, because they're forgiving, because they are so docile and so friendly. She said, we can test on them one day and come back the next day to their kennel and they're wagging their tails and ready for us to come back again. Mm. When we were driving home with them, I live in Southern California. These beagles were in Northern California. We were in the car with them and one of them, he kept giving us his paw like this. And I thought, oh, man, that's so cute. I was talking to her later. She said, oh, did one of them keep giving you his paw? And I said, yeah, you know, it's so cute. And she said, no, that's not cute. We actually trained him to give us his paw for blood.
Oh.
That's why they love them. They're so smart. They're so smart.
And trainable.
Yeah. And it's so something you would never think. I mean, I thought I knew everything about animal testing and animal cruelty and everything. I'm sorry, that's my dog. She's coughing in the background.
Hello. Where do they get the beagles for any of the animals for testing? Are there breeders that specifically do this?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. Yeah. So the majority of beagles and dogs who they use for testing come from commercial breeding facilities. There are a couple that are the biggest ones in the United States. The biggest one is called Marshall Bio Resources, which is in North Rose, New York. Mm-hmm. And that is one we've all been fighting against for a very long time because it's horrific. And there are a couple of others. Sometimes they get them from what's called Class B dealers. Shelters are considered Class B dealers. Mm-hmm. So there are several states in the United States that still do what's called pound seizure, meaning animal shelters will sell to animal testing facilities, which is really, really sad. So someone loses their dog or cat. For some reason, they never find them in the shelter. Unfortunately, they get sold to an animal testing facility, tested on, and killed.
Wow. So what percentage, how many are rescued from the testing facilities? Guesstimate.
Drop in the bucket.
Yeah.
There is a testing facility in everybody's backyard, I promise you. I mean, the thing is that the ones that you hear about are the public ones, publicly funded ones. They're the ones like the universities, you know, things like that. But there are private testing facilities everywhere in strip malls, you know, with the blacked out windows. That's a testing facility there. Wow. You just don't know about it.
Would you tell, Janet and I read the recent article about your group in the Washington Post, but would you please tell the audience how you came about this Oklahoma facility? I think it's fascinating.
Sure. Yeah. So every single year I write a letter to every animal testing facility in the United States. And my letter basically says, listen, you know, I know that you do animal testing. I know that we can agree to disagree. Well, I hope that we can agree to disagree that although we're on different sides of this, these animals deserve a chance at life after you're done with the testing. When you are done, please, instead of killing them, release them to us. And we hardly ever get a reply, as I'm sure you can imagine. But in 2021, the owner of this facility in Oklahoma did call me. And he said, listen, I got your letter. I've been getting your letters for years, but I'm responding today. And I'd like your help in placing some of our dogs, our really, really old dogs who have been here their whole lives. And I was floored, like so excited. Okay, great. Yes, we'll be there. So we started working with him in 2021 and driving out there and rescuing his dogs and cats and really, really old ones and placing them in homes. We're a foster-based network. Mm-hmm. And what happened was over time, I started seeing that, you know, I would go there and he and I developed a relationship and I kind of saw that there was a weakness in what he does in the industry. He's a private facility like the ones I was telling you about. Mm-hmm. And it seemed like there was a kind of a lull in his business. And I decided to propose something crazy and suggested that he go out of business. I said, listen, you know, I can see that you don't have much business going on. The dogs, I've seen the same dogs here year after year, the same cats. You know, we've talked and you've said that you don't have a lot of contracts going on. How would you feel about closing up your business? You have a beautiful 30-acre piece of land here. We'll buy the property. Of course, we don't want to give you any money for your business, but we'll buy the property off you and you close your business and relinquish your USDA animal testing license. And I really did think that he would laugh me off the phone, but he said, let me think about it.
Wow.
And I was just floored, like, what? Okay. And then he came back with, okay, give me $1 million for my business. Give me, you know, several hundred thousand dollars for the property and it's a deal. And I said, it's no deal. I'm not going to give you money for your business. Mm-hmm. And he said, okay, no deal. Mm-hmm. Fast forward. We negotiated and it became a deal. We didn't give him any money for his business. He relinquished his animal testing license to the USDA. Mm-hmm. And part of that deal also was we took custody of all of the animals. And we have now custody of all 200 plus because it's growing because mm-hmm. all of the animals were breeding. So we have lots of puppies. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we have the property and he is out of business. So.
Wow. Fabulous.
Yeah.
So how does someone like that become USDA certified? I had no idea that like the average Joe could. Mm-hmm. Wow.
Let me tell you how easy it is. I actually did an experiment myself.
Yeah.
So all you have to do is go online and fill out a form. And guess what?
Boom.
You can get licensed. It's sickening.
Wow.
And then companies have you do testing and they pay you for the testing results. So it's not exactly. Really. Wow. Wow.
I mean, that part is a little different. So you can get certified as a Class A USDA licensed person or company, but so his facility was a private toxic flea and tick testing facility. Mm-hmm. So what most people don't know, and I want them to know listening here, is that and I was guilty of this too, purchasing these products that are very toxic to your dogs and cats. Mm-hmm. The topical stuff we give them, Advantix, mm-hmm. Frontline, all of that was tested on by this facility, mm-hmm. Was used mm-hmm. by this facility. All of those commercial products that these animals suffered and died for. So the companies who make these products were the ones that were hiring him mm-hmm. to make these animals suffer. And I won't get into the specifics because they're really, really ugly. But let's just say these animals would have seizures. It's really bad. And if you read the inserts on these products, it says, if a side effect could be seizures. Mm-hmm. I urge people to use things like the natural alternatives, like, Wonderside or, Vet's Best, things like that, that are just as effective and that don't have these horrible chemicals. But what happens is these companies who use these toxic chemicals would hire him for certain studies. Like, we want you to use 25 dogs for this specific study. We want you to use, 5,000 of this breed of tick mm-hmm. for these dogs to see what happens, blah, 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 blah. And that's what they do.
And sadly, they feed them or apply to them 10 times or 100 times a normal dose. That the poor animal has to withstand that. Shannon, one thing I think must have been frustrating for you, because I know being involved in rescue, you want to get the dogs and cats out of there, but you can't go off on that person because then they won't call you. You know what I'm saying? Right. So it's kind of a push-pull thing where you kind of have to be nice and in back of your mind thinking, oh boy, I got to get these dogs out of here. We're from Ohio. And so, where we are on the bottom of the pile as far as puppy mill legislation. I mean, it's absolutely horrible. Because we have a big farm lobby, and that's what its auspices is under that. So I know when we we go to a puppy mill, and now we get that mill owner to call us when the females, he's done breeding them, because they'll take them out and shoot them or just let them go. And people don't realize that. And it kills you to have to be nice, but then if you're not, they won't call you.
Or they'll kill the dog. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm 100%. And, you know, I'm sure we feel the same way, where it's frustrating and people don't get that. And it's like, listen, it's the devil, yes. And you've got to work with them. Yeah. That's really the only way to do it.
Yeah.
And also, I've learned a lot of great inside information doing mm-hmm. this. I mean, the things I've learned, and this was all worth it. I mean, 100%. And this is something that's also never been done in the history of the animal rights world, to be able to do this, and then also turn it into what we're turning it into right now. I mean, it is massively huge. And so their relationships, the development, the information, it's huge. And now we're going to be able to take in so many animals from these places. We've already been contacted by different facilities to take in more animals.
Oh, I love it. You've got a trend going now. No, I think that's a good thing, because sometimes that's all it takes, is just one move and then everyone jumps on the bandwagon. I'm interested to find out how hard that legislation was to get through, because that's, in Ohio, we just had a fire in a puppy mill that killed 50 dogs. And I just went off on Facebook on that, on the legislators, and I couldn't stand it. I don't care if I get death threats or whatever, but I'm interested to know, how hard was it to get that Beagle Freedom Bill going?
Yeah. Each state was really different. And it was really interesting, because I thought, okay, California, my home state, was very liberal. Yeah. I thought, oh, it'll be really easy in California. Yeah. It wasn't. It took two sessions. We lost our first session. And also, I thought, this bill is so vanilla. Oh my, could it be more vanilla? Yeah. Like, I almost didn't want to do it, because it makes us sound so welfareist. Like, oh, when you're done with the testing, just let them free. Yeah. Because I don't believe in the testing. Obviously, our mission is to end animal testing. But we have to get the conversation going someplace, and we have to take baby steps, because animal testing isn't going to end overnight. So we thought, okay, let's start somewhere. Let's just start with this, because they're not letting them go of their own free will. They're not letting them go when I send them letters. They're not letting them go when I call them. I mean, some are, but it's very hard to convince them. So if they're not doing it that way, we have to force them through legislation. So, okay, we'll try it this way. And so, as I sort of alluded to earlier, the interesting part was, in California, the first session, we're up against, UC Davis, USC, UCLA. They're all fighting this, saying, these dogs are not meant to be in people's homes, blah, 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 blah. And then we have a line of all these dogs we have adopted out. People with their dogs saying, we have adopted these dogs. These dogs are meant to be in people's homes. And for some reason, we lost, which was crazy. Next session, we come back, and those very same people come back with photos, and they say, well, we don't need this legislation, because we have our own in-house adoption, and see these dogs, we've adopted them. And I'm like, last session you said they weren't meant to be in people's homes. So which is it?
Wow.
Yeah. So we passed, of course, because they were, shown to be liars. So in some states it was really hard to pass. Some we went through with flying colors, because some states hardly had any animal testing going on, like Nevada.
Oh, okay.
Nevada was really crazy, because there's only one lab there. And actually Nevada, it applied to all animals, which was amazing.
Oh, I love just it. Dogs and farm cows. Animals too. Mm-hmm. I love that.
Wow. All insane. Wow. That's the only state where it applies to all animals. Wow. We couldn't get that in any other state. It just depends. It depends on who you're fighting against, really. And of course, you never get the bill you want. The bill starts out, you could try to get it in as broad as possible, and then it's going to get pared down till, you basically hate it, and then it passes.
What's interesting to me, beagles are companion animals. I don't care who owns them. It's a companion animal. But apparently that word companion didn't mean anything to them.
Right. Right. Yeah. No.
Hey, did you know that for dogs and cats that could benefit from a prescription diet, Blue Buffalo offers natural veterinary diets formulated by animal nutritionists and veterinarians for certain dietary needs like kidney support, weight management, gastrointestinal support, and my particular favorite, dermatology. They make a food allergic diet that's an alligator-based called NP or a hydrolyzed salmon-based for dogs and cats called HF. Contact your veterinarian about these prescription Blue Buffalo diets.
So what's the journey like when you rescue the beagles from a facility? What happens next? I'm sure you have volunteers and...
Yeah. So usually what we do is, excuse me, we have a what we call a release location. So we go to a release location and we let them out for the first time in their lives, and we always want to document it. And so we open the cage doors and they get to, you know, feel freedom for the first time in their lives and walk around. And we have our foster homes waiting because they always go right into a foster home. Mm-hmm. And our foster families are there and get to watch them feel their freedom. Oh. And they go home to their fosters. And we do that because we want to be there every step of the way with the fosters. We have our team is there with them 24/7. We have 24/7 phone and email, so we can be with them, because people, even though they've been through our training process, they still are nervous, you know, because it's so, these dogs are so different. Like they, anything scares them, like any type of typical regular noise, the PTSD is really different for them than it is with other dogs. And so even though we've told them, once they get the dog home, it's a different experience. Mm-hmm. And so they will call us a lot, like, oh, you know, Jimmy is doing this, you know, oh my God, I'm scared, you know. So we're there for them like at midnight, 2 in the morning, and go through it with them and go through the vet care and things like that. And then once they sort of decompress, it takes about 2 to 3 weeks to just do the first decompression. Then their personalities start coming out. And that's when we know, like, okay, you know, then we can start matching them with their forever home. Because we can see what they're really like. Do they like other dogs? Do they like cats? Are they dog home? And that's when the foster says, well, I'm a foster family. I'm going to keep this dog. Or-
you know, it's interesting you said that, because I have a China rescue from Jill from China Rescue Dogs. And she, Gidget, she's around here somewhere. And she's a golden. She's 3. And she is very noise phobic. Very noise phobic. And I don't know if it was the 2-day flight over here. The other thing she's very wary of is like if you're cleaning the pool and you have the big pool, you know, pool. I can't even imagine.
And she doesn't like boxes or luggage.
Right. Like when you ask that. But yeah, it's, and then my other one's an Amish mill mama, and she's pretty good with everything. She nests a lot. She'll take towels from the bathroom and take it to her nest because she had a litter.
I was just going to say she had at least one litter.
And I can tell because her caudal mammary glands are a little scarred. But anyway, but the China rescue dog, very noise phobic, but she's getting better. And that's why we did one show on how to cope with when you rescue a dog from a puppy mill or the beagle thing, because people need to know you can't just put them on a leash and take them for a walk. You have to keep their stimulus low at first, you know, like you said, they've never, and I see on your Facebook group, the first time they're touching grass, I mean, I just get teary eyed. And they don't even know what a cat is. I'm sure if that household has a cat. So it's not just
exactly.
Yeah. It takes some patience on the owner's part, but man, is it rewarding. Ugh. Yeah.
It was 100%. You hit the nail on the head. That's what we tell people is, and so we have a decompression period. We have them build a deep, like you said, a decompression space that they can go to and that we want to keep them in, you know, and we have GPS collars on all of them because,
and double leash,
they will,
because they'll bolt.
Run.
Yeah.
Their first instinct is to run when they get scared.
Right.
And especially beagles, since they're scent hounds, they will also run for the door and for scent. And no matter how much you tell people, a kid will leave a door open or something like that. Yeah. And it's so funny.
Yeah. We had, on one of our episodes, we had the head of Golden Rescue, and she actually slept out in the Michigan winter for two weeks because someone adopted a dog and, you know, opened the hatch of the car. And of course they're like feral. They don't know that's their home. Mm-hmm. And she actually did catch the dog, but 2 weeks camping out in the winter. So you're right. People think that, they know their home now. They have no clue. They don't even know what a home is. Yeah. God bless them. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. That's awesome that she did that. We've definitely had similar circumstances, and it's the scariest thing because they don't know what is going on, and your heart breaks because they're just, you don't know what is going through their heads.
So Shannon, what's your most interesting or favorite beagle rescue story?
Oh yeah. I'd love to hear that.
Oh my goodness.
You gotta narrow it down.
I would say probably our fourth rescue. So that was back in 2011. Mm-hmm. Simply because we were just getting started, and we rescued 40 beagles from a laboratory in Spain. Mm-hmm. And we had to arrange for all 40 to be on a plane together. And they arrived here all together on Thanksgiving. And this was, you know, when, you know, we had just gotten started. We didn't even have a real website. You know, it was just literally me and my two friends who were volunteering, and I was, it was just, there wasn't anything even really organized. And, they were all male dogs and they were all unneutered. So you get it back.
Thank goodness they were all male and there were no women involved.
Well, that's true. However, they all came to my home in my backyard. It was a very rainy
night. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
And it was insanity. It was the best night ever. And the most insane night ever of literally, and then, you know, tons of people were there because they came there to help and then to foster. But like, there were literally like 40 male unneutered crazy beagles in my backyard going ballistic. And I was like, oh my gosh, what is happening right now? And you just see like photos and videos of us like clean that up. Oh my, break. Oh my God. They're humping. They're doing this. It was like insane, like just crazy. And of course, you know, there weren't enough people at the time to like foster all of them. So for like the next, I think month, I had between like 30 and like 20 and 30 dogs in my yard.
Just like, imagine the poop patrol.
Yeah, no, and it was stormy and muddy that whole time. So like you were wearing like, and we're not used to this, okay, in Southern California and LA, like mud boots and everything every day, like mucking in the yard. And like, it was such an experience, but one like I'll never forget and never take back. And they were already like 5 or 6 years old. And so we have a private Facebook group where, like all of our fosters and adopters are on it. Mm-hmm. And so we all keep in touch, of course, and we know when a dog passes away and everything. And so, you know, of course, you know, throughout the years, many have passed, and there are like, I think one or two still alive. And one Kipper, he just had his 17th birthday yesterday.
Oh, wow.
That's fabulous.
Wonderful. Well, we have a question for you that we ask all of our guests. First of all, thank you for the amazing work you do. You're truly making a difference.
I think I'm going to call her St. Shannon, because anyone that has 40 male unneutered beagles in their backyard, that's my kind of person.
Warning, she's moving in. what is your pet or human peeve?
Okay. Yeah. It would be not closing or tightening lids on things. I can't stand it.
That's a good one. Like the toothpaste, like a jar of mayonnaise.
Exactly. Yeah. Like jars and covers on things. Yeah. I have at my office, it's a house, home office. Uh-huh. And so it's a bunch of people who work there. And like literally I'll go to grab something and like everything will fall out of it because people just like put it on and don't close it. And I'm like, why? Yeah. Why don't you close the lid?
I hate when they put like the empty carton of like cream or milk in the fridge.
Yes.
And then you go to pick it up and you're like, whoa, wait a minute.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Right. Or like, oh yeah, that gives me that. Here's another one. It's like, there's the entire, like, you know how the soda cans come in the case, right? Like the cardboard.
Yeah. Yeah.
Case.
Yeah. Yeah. With the ringy
there's
thing.
The
yeah.
Case in there with one soda can in it. I'm like, take the soda can out and then throw the.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or the bottom of the orange juice. Like there's one sip left. What are you saving that for? I mean, just.
And it's taking up like this much room in the fridge.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or the other one is like you have the stuff in the Tupperware. And I live with my son and my husband. And they'll say, well, when did you cook that? And I'm like, I don't know. Like 2 days ago. It's fine. It's not going to kill you. But, you know, like I'm supposed to be in charge. Of knowing everything has gone bad.
I was going to vet school, I lived on leftovers. I as you know, I came home every other weekend because I worked.
Yeah.
And so I would make like vegetarian chili and then take it to Columbus and eat it all week.
Right.
So I love leftovers. Here, it's like opening the fridge. What's there to eat? There's like a million leftovers in there.
Or here's my other favorite with sorry, Duke with men. Where's the ketchup?
Oh, yeah.
Like, look around. You know, like explore. Don't just look straight ahead.
Yeah.
Now, makes me
wait,
nuts.
Before we go with Shannon, tell how many pets and what do you have and what are their names?
Yeah, who's next to you?
Okay, so this is Maya. Now she's falling asleep. She can't really get her.
We bored her, Janet. We bored her. She's sleeping now. Maya's sleeping.
Yeah,
she's totally bored.
Yeah.
She's my rescued Great Dane from the South LA shelter. And then I have another dog named Gracie. She's a pit bull from the North Central shelter in LA. Mm-hmm. I have a cat named Faith. She's also from the North Central shelter.
Oh.
And then I have a rescued turtle and tortoise.
Oh. Hey, a turtle and a tortoise? What are their names?
Baltazar and Harriet.
Well, Shannon, I have to tell you, I'm reading a wonderful book. It's called Of Turtles and Men. I can't put it down. It's about, it's a group in New England that rescues every kind of turtle, including snapping turtles. And then they make, you know, little things for their plastron so they don't drag. It's very good. Of Turtles and Men.
Oh.
Yeah.
Very good. I'm new to the whole turtle thing. Like, I got Harriet. She's actually a really rare tortoise. Mm-hmm. She's a Bell's Hunchback tortoise. Mm. And, the only reason I got her was because she was being abused by somebody. Somebody told me. And so I went and got her.
Oh my God.
Like I'm not like a reptile person at all. And I was like, what do I do?
Mm-hmm.
But then like I fell in love with her. She's so interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And then my gardener found a tortoise like randomly. He's like, can you take her? Cause he knew I had, he found a turtle. He knew I had a tortoise. I'm like, okay. And he's a slider. And so I have this whole like situation set up outside and they're awesome. Like they're so interesting. Now I'm like into them.
They're very emotional. They really are. They're very, and they're very soulful. People don't realize that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's fascinating. Like she, like Harriet loves her, her shell rubbed and everything. And she makes all these noises.
Yeah.
It's fascinating. I'm like, okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. People, apparently that their shell, the plastron, it has nerve endings in it. And they actually love to be stroked like that.
Yeah. Huh.
You know, Janet, we have to put on the program, we have to put on the podcast companies that don't test so that we can, we can have people patronize those companies.
Oh, that would be great if we can get a test list.
Because that's just as important. So we don't patronize those companies.
Yeah.
Oh, speaking of, I have an app everyone should download.
Oh, yes.
It's free.
Oh, okay.
It's called Cruelty Cutter. Cruelty Cutter. It's a free app. that we developed. And all you do is you scan the barcode of any product, yeah, and it will instantly tell you if it's cruelty-free or not. And it will also give alternatives to the product that you're looking for if it is not cruelty-free. And you can share your results on social media. It will instantly tag the company, which is great. And we have something pre-written. So like a bad company will be tagged. Like, I don't know, you know, Procter & Gamble will be tagged. And we'll say, I didn't buy your product because you're not cruelty-free.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. That's cool.
Make sure we put the link on for that too.
Oh, that's great. Okay.
I'm going to add that actually as soon as this is over.
Anyway, now, could you also, if folks are interested, is anyone in the U.S. can they adopt from you?
Just go to our website, bfp.org, and you'll see a little icon at the top to foster or adopt or rescue, and fill out the app. Yeah, anywhere in the U.S. and we transport, or you can head out to Oklahoma and go check them out.
Volunteer, right? At the facility, from what I read.
Yes, we need volunteers desperately at our new facility in Oklahoma.
How many vets do you have there? Are they volunteer vets or are they employees or what?
Well, right now they're just contractors. I mean, we just have one vet who has been coming to do the spays and neuters. And then, you know, there are some vets nearby that we take them to, but you know, since we just got started, I mean, we don't have any vets on staff, which, I mean, that's a goal that we have, of course, in the future. So if anybody's interested, let us know, email us. But we're building all that out. We need funds for that, of course. But if anybody is interested, let us know.
There are actually two really great nationwide volunteer sites where you can post volunteer opportunities, volunteermatch.com, and believe it or not, AARP. And there are two great resources. Yep. You can put in, like, if I'm looking for a volunteer opportunity, I could put in animals, and it'll show where your location is and where you can volunteer. It's fantastic.
Wow, thank you.
Yeah.
Awesome. We'll check those out. Thank you.
And it's free.
Janet heads up nonprofit, so she's the... that expert. I'm medical. She's social.
And I'm all about F-R-E-E, one of my favorite four-letter words.
Yes.
We like that.
That's right.
One of my favorite four-letter words.
Right.
Wow, Shannon, thank you so much. You're doing amazing work, and we're so appreciative of how you're helping pets. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks for having me on. Thanks for all the great work you all do.
And Janet, like we always say, gotta love a beagle.
Got a lot of people. Hail to Snoopy. Take care, Shannon. Thank you so much.
You too.
Well, Janet, should we wind it up? This is Dr. Alice Novotny Jeroman and
Janet Novotny King,
the Novotny sisters, saying kiss your pets
and give them an extra biscuit from
Bye.
Us.
Bye. Have a great day.
If you are interested in volunteering or donating to the Beagle Freedom Project, please check out their website at bfp.org, which is listed in the description page of this podcast.
Hey, thanks for tuning in today. We hope you found the science-based information provided helpful in taking care of your pet. Check out our other Speaking of Pets episodes wherever you get your podcasts.
We'd love to hear from you. So email your pet photos and or pet peeves to contact@speakingofpetspod.com. Remember to follow Speaking of Pets on all social media.